Finally tonight, the 2010 Nobel Prize for Economics. It was awarded today to two Americans, Peter Diamond of MIT and Dale Mortensen of Northwestern University, and to Christopher Pissarides, a British-Cypriot economist. Diamond got the news as he returned home to the Boston area from an overseas trip.
Fortunately, I was sitting down and I wasn't behind the steering wheel. And it kind of takes your breath away. It's just you suddenly realize not only is it the moment, but also there are all sorts of changes in your life, opportunities opening up, all sorts of things that are going to be different.
Diamond and his colleagues were recognized for research into why markets often don't work as expected, particularly the job market. Joining us to explain is Catherine Rampell of the New York Times. Catherine, the economist won for work in so-called search theory. Can you give us the layman's definition of that?
Basically, that refers to research about markets where buyers and sellers don't automatically find each other. And that really refers to almost all markets except for things like commodities. So in the job market, that means why does it take so long for people who are unemployed to find jobs even when there are job openings available?
All right, so that's a particularly relevant question right now. Tell us what the research suggests about the situation as these economists studied it, but also as it applies to what we're looking at now.
Well, basically, they were interested in, again, why does it take so long for people to be matched to jobs? And their conclusion had a lot to do with the fact that people are not interchangeable units. You know, different people have different skills, they have different weaknesses, they have different strengths, and jobs, for that matter, are also not identical cookie-cutter things. So what happens is it takes time for the right person to be matched to the right job. And beyond that, there are government policies that at times can make the search process less efficient. So when we're talking about what's going on now, a lot of that has to do with the demand picture, but it can also have to do with the fact that it takes time for people to be matched to the right job because they're unwilling to move if their house is underwater, for example.
Well, you know, explain for the layman, why is that a sort of aha? I mean, that's as opposed to what economic theory should tell us about matching people to jobs.
I know it sounds pretty intuitive, right? But back in the 70s, it was actually quite controversial, in part because there was this idea that markets were efficient, that, you know, why doesn't the wage just drop so that a company sees a new hire is more attractive and a person who's unemployed will just take the job because they need the job. What happened was, around the time of the 70s, there was this more expansive, more nuanced thinking about the fact that markets where goods are not totally interchangeable, in this case goods are people, means different things. And how do you sort of characterize what takes so long? How are people different? How does the fact that when people get discouraged about finding a job affect the likelihood of their being placed in a job? So a lot of what's interesting about this research is just that it sort of expanded what people thought about when they thought about economics and how to think about the job market. But beyond that, it's also been applied, the same types of principles have been applied to the housing market, to finance, to marriage, to all sorts of different things.
Now, are there applications or implications for government policy in all of this?
There are a few. Well, I mean, there's been a lot of research in this vein, especially more recently. But one of the key points from these three researchers' work is that sometimes government policies can have unintended consequences. The big example that I'm sure anti-stimulus people would like to cite is unemployment benefits. Unemployment benefits are given for many different reasons, including compassion. But one effect of that is, at least at the margins, if you're paid not to work, then that means you have slightly less incentive to go out and find a job. So that's the kind of policy that we're talking about.
As you say, that's been part of the discussion we've been having on this program and in the debate in Washington.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But that's not the only thing that their work touches on. You know, I had the opportunity to press conferences or talk with each of the winners today, and all of them were asked about what the implications of their work was for current policy. And at least two of the three strongly emphasized the fact that we really want people to be put back to work as quickly as possible, because the longer they're out of the labor force, the harder it is to get them back to work. They become detached from work, their skills might deteriorate, they might be stigmatized. There are all sorts of bad things that can happen. And they talk about how their work has this, basically shows that the longer you're apart from the labor force, the sort of more entrenched that undercurrent of unemployment becomes. And this is one of the problems that Europe faced, let's say, in the 70s and 80s, where they had this sort of underclass of chronically unemployed people.
There is a kind of interesting, before I let you go, an interesting sidebar to all this. Perhaps the best known of the winners is Peter Diamond. He's been nominated to be on the Federal Reserve Board, right?
Absolutely. And I'm sure this is a happy day for him on many levels. But one particularly ironic level, I guess, is that he was nominated back in April, and his nomination was effectively blocked by the Republicans in the Senate, in part because some Republicans, including Richard Shelby, had said that he was too inexperienced, that they didn't want someone on the Fed who was, quote, learning on the job. So, you know, this was a nice little comeuppance, I'm sure, for Professor Diamond today to be able to say, yeah, you know, I have some credentials under my belt. And actually, he was renominated a couple of weeks ago, and there is an implication that this little plaudit on his resume might help him more smoothly get through the confirmation process.
I also saw he has a good sense of humor. He said this was almost as good, I think he said it's almost as good as 2004 when the Red Sox finally won the World Series, right? He's a big Red Sox fan.
He's a big Red Sox fan. He actually threw out the opening pitch a couple months ago, I think.
Oh, bigger than I knew. Okay, Catherine Rampell, The New York Times. Thanks very much.
Thank you.